Welcome to session 14.
What are we doing today? Sand carving wood. And I want to thank you for joining us. Thank you for bearing with us. We had some technical difficulties this morning. And as you know, we run live. So things can happen. And I
thank you for being patient with us, but we are up and running. What are we doing today? We are sand carving wood. So we have some wood products that are finished with a finished surface and an unfinished surface. So we have a lot planned for you today. So here are some of my samples of sand carving wood, applying a photoresist and sandblasting. And with sand carving wood, you have depth, you have detail with your photoresist film, but you have choices in color. And that's what is remarkable is you can get creative with color when it comes to sand carving wood. Yes, you can laser, and there's nothing wrong with lasering, but there are a few occasions when you can sand carve it. Maybe you don't have a laser, you can still provide wood products. Maybe you do have a laser, but you want to add a color fill, or doing an odd shape, you can sandblast it. So today I'm going to show you how you can apply your photoresist film, sandblast it, add a paint fill. What are some of the tips and techniques when it comes to sand carving wood? I know some of you have had a residue on some of the wood products. We're going to deal with that today and show you how you can fix that. But what else do we have going on? I have a special guest, and I'm so excited about this one. You know, we only know so much. And I work 8 hours, 10 hours a day. We work on sand carving. We work on photoresist film. But we need to pull from those people that do this for a living, that are doing it 12, 14 hours a day. And I have an expert coming in, and he sand carves wood. 100% of his products is sand carved wood. He doesn't laser them. He sandblasts them. And he's a remarkable young man. You can see here, here's some of his products here. And he goes deep with this, with the wood product. He has a color fill. You can see all this fine detail in here. Everything that he's done is remarkable. And he's a passionate young man. I've had the pleasure of speaking with him for several hours last week, and I'm just so impressed with him, with his passion, with his creativity, and his desire to have his own business and push a unique product. And it's not easy, as you know, to have your own business. It's not like you wake up one day and you're like, I'm ready to start my business and make some money. Yes, that's a great idea. It's a great plan. But on that journey, you have some ups and downs. And I'm really excited about bringing on this guest to show some of his ups and downs, but how he made it through and what avenues he took to be successful in this industry of sand carving wood. So we will bring him on in just a few minutes, but let's talk about some of the things that you can do when it comes to wood products. Recycled wood. So recycled wood is huge right now, and we have a customer that actually has a business of doing his artwork and then using our photoresist film and putting it on recycled wood. And it's actually, you have some wonderful pieces, and I don't know if they're able to show those, but we do have some wonderful pieces of his that we can put up on our site. But just to give you ideas of artwork and different things that you can do with sand carving wood. And that is our segment today, sand carving wood. We have Gabe joining us from Straight. And before we present him, we're going to show a video of him. He has a story. And today, our story is Carve Your Story with Gabe from Straight. And I hope you stay tuned. I hope you listen. He has a great perspective on business and passion. And I was so excited when we spoke with him. And I hope that you can grab a few of his nuggets when it comes to business, social media, his perspective. So stay tuned. Don't stay with me. And we're going to play the video real quick here.
Keep from landing in jail. And I
Gabe, who is the owner of Straight, and you know, he was positioned, he was trained, he was prepped. He was prepped to be a professional baseball player, very talented and extremely could be a professional baseball player. But he chose a different path with starting his own business. And let's bring on Gabe. And let's see here. Hi, Gabe. And hopefully you guys can hear him. And basically, Gabe is from California, but he lives in the Midwest now. And he has a business called Straight, where he had a concept out of a need. And on that concept he needed to get someplace. So I believe it was a mission of, you need to get someplace when you don't have wheels. And I believe that was originally how he started. Now I'm having a little trouble hearing him, so bear with me just a moment. And can you hear me, Gabe? Sorry, bear with us just a moment here. And I'm really hoping this works because he's...
Hey, Liz.
There we go. Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
I can.
Great. So you had a concept that came out of a need. And basically, tell us the story behind Straight.
I mean, I think you asked me a question, but I'm having a little trouble on my end over here.
Okay, so he can't hear. Okay, so we'll see if we can get you the question real quick here. The story behind Straight, I know it was, again, a concept that was created out of a need. He was had the concept from college. So I believe as a freshman, you went to college to become a baseball player, and you were attending college and playing baseball.
Yeah.
And
so yes. I guess I'll just
you're good.
I'll just start telling the story of Straight and how everything got started. I was at like you said, I was a baseball player. I could read your lips, and I saw you say baseball player. So obviously everybody thinks they're going to be a professional at the sport that they're playing when they're a kid. I kind of had like a I had a knack for it, and I got to go play at Oral Roberts University. It's in Oklahoma. So one of the interesting things about that is I was like 130 pounds. I was really, really tiny. So they didn't really even want me to walk to, like, they would have a golf cart come get me from the dorms to take me down to practice because I couldn't burn any calories. I had to gain like 30 pounds that year. So I started skating a lot, because it was mostly downhill. So I just started skating a bunch, and security had a big problem with that. Cause back then, especially out here in Oklahoma, skaters had a real, like, it was looked at as like a crime because we're always like destroying things, you know, even though I wasn't skating like that, I was just skating on little cruisers like you see behind you. So basically I kept getting my boards taken away by security, and it started getting expensive. And one day I came back for, I think it was like Thanksgiving break or something like that, and I had just been around the sand carving industry my whole life, so I knew what it was about, but I didn't know if it would work on wood. And I figured, like, hey, I should make a I think I can just get like a plank of wood like they did back in the old days, like the very first skateboards. They just got a plank of wood and drilled some clay wheels into them. So what I did was I wanted to give a nod to the original shape. So we bought a bunch of different types of wood, and just had a little plank. It was like a 3/4 inch, something that you don't typically ride on, but I wanted to blast artwork on it. And I thought that that would be the thing that really made it unique to break into the industry, because the skate industry, just like the fashion industry, or really any industry, if you don't know anyone in it and your product isn't like really unique, like above and beyond, or have some kind of unique thing to it, like, you're gonna have a hard time breaking into that. But I came back and the mask stuck on there, which I was really surprised, because wood is kind of has some soft spots, so I didn't know if I was going to have a lot of blow-offs or like what the deal was. But the mask, I've never really had issues with the mask holding up. So I blasted it, and then I went to paint it, when I peeled it off, I was like, oh, this is it. Like, I gotta, made an Instagram page. And then I don't know how deep you want me to get into it, because I'm having a little trouble hearing, but I can keep going.
Well, let me ask you this: what type of wood do you use right now? What are your main, or what type of woods do you use, and why? I believe you use like a bamboo. And then I know you like a
bamboo,
dark wood. You have a couple that are dark. You have a dark in color.
Yeah, hold on one second.
We're having a little bit of technical difficulties with the sound. So
my audio is kind of down for a second.
So the question, if you can hear me, is what type of woods material do you use?
Okay, so I started to use bamboo just because after experimenting with a bunch of different types of woods, and you can do any wood, and every wood has different softness and hardness to it, and all of it has its own characteristics when you blast into it. Like, you can see some of the grains come to life. Like, it's wood in a totally different way than you've ever seen it before, and it's kind of even hard to gauge on camera, but you can see, like, it has those straight lines down there, and then it'll have some of the little knuckles, like those little knots in the wood are called knuckles. And like, it's just cool because it makes everything you do unique, and it gives it its own thing. So you can have a really like cohesive design, but the wood, the grain is going to give everything its own unique little thing. And if you do have blow offs, which sometimes the wood will kind of give you a little bit of flake off or something like that, and it really just makes it even that much more unique. Like, we got really like intricate designs back there, and I don't mind any type of little chips or anything like that. Like, it kind of makes it, for what I'm doing, I like it. So I started using bamboo because bamboo was the most accessible, and we kind of got we had a big thing with Instagram. They did a feature on us, and we needed to make them on like a massive scale and kind of start scaling up. And we couldn't do that if we were gluing boards together using just like regular sheets of wood. So bamboo is kind of like the thing to use. It's one of the most durable things. So yeah, we just kept using that, and it's really easy to work with.
So let me ask you this. I know we have a lot of questions for you, so I really want to make sure we deliver your passion through this segment here. Now, you use SR2000, and we make the mask for you, and we spray on the adhesive. Do you ever deal with, like, a residue on the wood surface after blasting? So do you ever deal with like a residue of the glue after you blast?
So, you know, there's a little bit of residue. Is that what you're asking about?
Yes.
A residue. It's not even really a thing. I think it mostly affects, I think the weather has a lot to do with it. If it's real humid outside, that wood is going to soak up a lot of that humidity. And wood is porous, so it flexes and it changes shape even when you get it wet. And then when it dries out, it's going to shrink and get a little bigger. So I think it holds in some of the humidity sometimes, and then it'll be a little gummy when you're taking it off. But I mean, that's nothing really. It's not, it's totally worth the artistic value that you get from it. It's not a problem at all.
So that's great, because I get that question sometimes on people dealing with residue. And so thank you for answering that. One of the questions that I have for you, that when we spoke last week, you talked about social media and Instagram played a big part. And then we talked about passion, but how did social media kind of fuel your product? And I know you were really big on the filming the process, because it is hard work to sandblast versus just putting it in a laser and lasering it. So your concept is work, what you do here, your whole product, you can tell. So tell us about that, of how you kind of use the process to have a respect for the product, in a sense.
Yeah, so I, when when we were when I went back to school, like at the very beginning of everything, straight wasn't even a thing yet, and I was trying to figure out kind of a way to get out of school. So I was just, I locked myself in my room, and I was just kind of, I was reading a lot of books. I was like, I read everything that I could really get my hands on. I was just looking for some kind of inspiration. So when I peeled that mask off, I was like, yeah, this is it. Like, I'm going to go back. And there was this new platform called Instagram, and it was like, they had just started in like 2012, 2011, something like that. Yeah, it was around then. So it was a pretty new platform still. And I had always liked taking photographs, but this worked so well for the skateboards because we have such a visual product. And what I did was I made an Instagram page for that, and I called it Straight Street. That was the original name. It was Straight Street.
Right.
And then I started liking people's pictures under that skateboard hashtag. Like, you can search little hashtags, like you can search wood or wood carving or skateboard. So I would go under skateboard, and everybody who tagged skateboard was in there. So I started liking their photos. They would come to my page, and then they would follow my stuff. So I got a couple thousand followers in a few weeks, and I sold a few boards. I think I sold like four or five over Instagram. And then I always went through all of my, I always went through all of my followers, just to kind of see like who liked my stuff. Because if you liked whatever I did, like, I thought you were rad too, you know, like, I just,
yeah,
I thought it was, it meant something. All of my, all the followers meant something to me. So, and I was looking to see like what they liked, like kind of what kind of photos they posted, just to see like who, I didn't know anything. So I was trying to figure out how I could, who I was making these things for, right? So there was one guy, his name was Josh, that I realized, I was looking through and I saw that his name was just Josh. So that would be like you getting just Liz or me getting just Gabe. We'd have had to be the first Liz or Gabe to make an Instagram page. So I was like, man, he's got to be like the first guy named Josh to do that. So I went to his profile, and he was one of the founding members of Instagram. I think he was, it was like he was a part of the original 12. So he was following my stuff. He would always like it. And we kind of went back and forth here and there. He would leave a comment every once in a while saying how cool it was. And so I just packed up and left one day because I sold, I think I sold like four boards at once for like $350 a piece to this guy. Out of, he was just a skater like at the skate park, and he bought all of them.
Wow.
So I was like, okay, like this is gonna work, you know, like so I packed up my stuff and I left, and I think it was like the week before finals. But I found what was gonna get me out of there, you know, and it was such a unique thing, like, and sand carving is so like untapped that's really what I knew people were gonna freak out when they saw it because of the attention that we were getting. So when I came back, had a little warehouse space, and I noticed that Josh was, he was just down the street from the warehouse, and their headquarters is up in San Francisco. So he was visiting down here at the beach, and I told him like, hey, you should come over. I'll give you a board. Like, I started this whole brand through Instagram. And I left, I actually just left school a couple months ago, and the first 4 months we didn't really sell anything at all. So me and him talked, and he's like, man, I love your story. Like, we really want to feature, we want to do a blog post on you. And back then blogs were on compute, like websites. So I didn't really understand what he meant. But I do remember him being like, he set up an interview. So I did an interview with this other guy that worked there. And the other guy was like, yeah, so we're going to go live at noon. And I was like, okay, cool. And he was like, are you excited? Like, he knew that it was going to be huge for us, but I had no clue what they were even talking about. I thought it was just like a simple little interview.
Right.
And so that day, the next day he texted me, he's like, hey, we're going to go live at noon. Like, make sure you're ready. And I had no clue what that means, ready. Like, I'm ready, you know? And so as soon as they went live, they, our website crashed, like, I think like 10 minutes later, because we had so many people coming to it. So at the end of that, like, we had hundreds of orders that basically like kickstarted the brand. A lot of retailers found us through that. So yeah, it was all because of that kind of net. It was, whenever I break it down to how the brand started, it was always, I put in the work in my dorm room trying to figure out some kind of inspiration for something. And then whatever I was doing, like in my life, I kind of took it and I just wanted to make a fun little skateboard. I really didn't think it was like anything other than that. And then when I saw it, I just realized like, hey, this is it. So the product came right after that. And it's such a unique process that like, it just makes sense to do these kinds of things. And then documenting, I knew that skaters would like really appreciate the documentation of the journey to make that skateboard, because every single one of them is made by hand. Like there's no computers involved other than the designing of the actual design, the artwork. So they're a real like DIY kind of people. They do it yourself kind of things. They build their own ramps. They're a very like raw community. So I knew that they would love the fact that this was such a raw product and a raw process. And it was really aggressive. Like we blast these things at like 120, you know, like 120 PSI, like that's a lot. And you usually do a glass at like, right, what, 20, 30,
40, I can get up to 40,
something like
45.
That. I don't do a lot of glass. So, right. But anyway, so I knew that they would like that. And we got like 15,000 followers that night. By the end of it, we ended with 30,000 new followers. And it was just kind of like an overnight thing. It was my first experience with like going viral on something, because they had 30 million people following them. So they put it out to every single one of them.
So
and
let me ask you this.
Yeah, it was big.
Let me ask you this, Gabe. What do you say to people who have their business and maybe they're a little bit on social media, a little bit on Facebook? What do you say to them about the process of sand carving? Because it is a unique process. It is a hand process, a handmade product. What do you say to those people that maybe dabble in social media slightly for their business?
One second. So you're talking about the process on social media, right? Documenting that kind of.
Right.
So that thing, I think that's like one of the most important things for me, is that people aren't necessarily always looking for the product. Like they'll buy the product, but they really invest in the story, right? It's just like, I've always looked at it as like a relationship, like with a person. Like you can meet somebody, but then you really get invested in them because of who they are and their story and like their background and how they grew up. Like all of everything in the world is made up of stories from the past. So I think it's really important to like tell the story of the process. And with this, like it's so hands-on, and it's so like people don't understand what's going on when they see it. So it just makes you look like a genius. You know what I mean? So like you just, if you do this and people don't get it and they're like, wow, what is he doing? Like it actually looks like, you know, harder than, like I've seen people carve things out of wood.
Right.
And it's not as mysterious because like I knew they grew up doing that. Like this is a totally different thing. You put a mask down and you're shooting sand at it. Most people, when they think of sandblasting, they think of car parts, you know? So sandblasting paint off of car parts. So whenever they see that this is the end result of the work that you did, it's just like people can't believe that you get that detailed. And if you document all of that with an iPhone, like iPhone is one of the best cameras out there. So it's super easy to do it now, and I don't see any reason why you shouldn't tell your story behind that best cup of coffee sign or behind the popcorn bowl. Like those are the kinds of things that hook people, right? And those are the kinds of things where it's like they need to know how much work you put into it, you know. So
you said something.
Yeah, that's on social media.
You said something to me last week, and you said when people see the process, you got to film the process or film what you do, and you put it out there on social media. When they see that, they respect the product. And I really think that's really great, your concept, your view on that, because it is a handmade product. So when we can film something, being produced, being made, that it's made here and it's made with our hands. It's handmade. It has the craftsmanship of our abilities here, and we promote that product. Now you can start charging for that product. So your skateboards, you know, you can buy a skateboard for, you know, I'm sure you can go down to the local store and get a skateboard. It's not of good quality, but you can get it. Your skateboards are different, and it's the design that comes across in that board. That design, every design means something to you. And that's one thing that I find unique about your product and with sandblasting is you can take your design, put it into PhotoResist, and then sandblast it. So let's talk about some of your, what's your favorite design, your favorite collection?
You asked about my favorite collection?
Yes.
So the my favorite collection would be that I'll Take You There. And that's one of the boards from the collection. That's actually one of my favorite boards that nobody ever bought that one for whatever reason. I got a lot of compliments on it, but nobody ever bought that one. But that was my favorite collection because that was kind of, that was when we were expanding like pretty quickly. We were doing a lot of trade shows. We were getting into a lot of shops. I think we had a couple hundred retailers, something like that. Maybe it was like 160 or whatever it was, but we were getting out like nationally. And then we had just, signed a distributor in South Korea. So there was a lot of like cool things that were happening. And I went back to in my mind about how I started. And the name I'll Take You There is kind of, there's a couple meanings behind it, but I'll Take You There was just like, these boards are going, like, it was about the journey. Like this, the product, like I saw the product in my mind and I just kept going towards that. You know, I would make things that were cool, but it was never really there where I saw it. And so I kept going until I got what I saw in my mind. And so that's why I felt like, well, these boards took me there because, you know, like this thing took me all the way. And I just kept going towards like that vision that I had. And so I'll Take You There meant that for me personally, is that the boards took me to all over the country now, you know, and even South Korea. So, but then it's just kind of like, I'll Take You There. Like this is, it's like a romantic thing between you and your skateboard. Like skaters are really connected to their skateboard. A lot of them use it for transportation. So
they're passionate.
It's just, like, that's what it means.
Passionate, like, about what you do. And that's, I know my kids, both of them have boards, and I remember them purchasing the boards, and they would, every day I'd come home from work and they're like, mom, okay, I finally found the board I want. And then they would online, they would choose the colors. And this is actually my son's board. I had to take it from him today. He rides it a few times a week. But I'm like, it's too good to ride. It looks too pretty. But this is my favorite one, this Native American with the chief. I love that. And he was able to choose the colors online and so excited to purchase his board and my daughter as well. And just kind of having that, creating it, making it online. And then I know that you sandblasted it and then, you know, they were able to pick it up. But I think that's great for people to buy something that is handmade, handcrafted, but has your design on there and has a design that you created. What do you say, what's the inspiration for your design or some of your designs?
Hold on a second. Sorry, there's a little lag. So the inspiration kind of comes between when I first start, like I wanted to, well, I won't say that name because I actually might use that name later, okay. But there was a name I had for the brand that kind of encompassed all different types of cultures. Like I wanted to pay respects to everybody's culture and to everybody's like flavor of design. And it was really hard because especially back then, social media wasn't the huge thing that it is now. Like it was, Facebook was huge, but that was pretty much it. So there was a lot of like mystery on how to connect with your customer, you know, like because there was these rules that everybody put in place to where you got to stay within this box and you can't go outside that box as a brand, and kind of that's how it was. So, but I really wanted to give like that bandana board back there, that paisley print, like that just has like, I feel like that touched a lot of different parts of what I was interested in and how I grew up. Like I grew up with like a bunch of cowboy stuff and going to Tombstone and watching Tombstone. So I knew that people would appreciate that in middle America. And then also like there's a big lowrider culture out here and even like a gang culture. And that board right there, specifically that blue and the red, was made for kind of like a Bloods and Crips thing, like on the same board. It was like, there was definitely deeper meanings in it than that. And it was never really said, because it's kind of a weird thing to say, but that was like the inspiration behind that kind of design. And then that Native American chief, like we're next to Pechanga. I got a lot of friends who are Native American. So
Pechanga.
Yeah, there's a lot of things. I kind of wanted to touch everything.
Sure. And I know that you, this is one of the designs that you got inspiration from. I know this is one of your friends and you did the book.
That's actually one of my most favorite designs. Sorry if I cut you off.
No,
but that one right there, that was the most amazed I've ever been at seeing something come out. I didn't think any of those little letters were going to come out at all. I mean, because they're so thin, they're literally hand drawn, and it just came out perfect. Like, I think that's one of the coolest boards, and it's not one of my designs either. That was a collaboration we did with an artist named Manifest, and he had wrote that book, and he, I'd known him for a long time, so he reached out and wanted to do that, and I told him, I was like, I don't think this is going to come out, dude, because we actually did a project every year with Metallica. So we did a, that's how we got into the, once he saw those Metallica boards, and it was a limited edition thing for Metallica. It was 250 pieces every season for them. And he saw that and he's like, dude, I want to do this. And so I didn't think it was going to work, but it worked. And now I know like it, you can pretty much do, you can make the design work with this stuff. Like
with the photoresist film and with our photoresist film. So you have, I know that you've done some boards, you've done like some celebrities, I believe Tupac is one of them that came out really nice with that design that you did on the boards. I don't know if they have that picture, but we can show that. And all we're doing is we're just trying to take this young man who had this design and took this concept and created it into a business using his passion and his experience, and then as well as using social media. And so he did spend some time on that social media trying to see who was following him and took some care into that. And I love how you said your followers, everyone meant something to you because they were following you and your concept, your ideas. And you can see that board there. That came out really nice, Gabe, that board that they're showing of Tupac. And I believe, did you display that at a trade show?
Yeah, sorry, it's still lagging a little bit. But I think I heard you right. Were you talking about the followers?
Yes, and then as well as the board that we have there, the that we're showing the Tupac boards that you did, that design.
Oh yeah, so that Tupac board.
Yes.
That was actually another collaboration with an artist, his name's Neil Shigley. We showed that. I did that because we were invited to the Magic Show, and basically it's like the biggest, it's the biggest fashion trade show in the world. And we were one of two skate brands that were invited there. So it, they basically gave me a space to do like an art show. Like half of it was an art show, half of it was like a wholesale spot for me for the retailers. But yeah, I did that project with Neil Shigley, helped me out on that, and he does a lot of portraits. But that's the other thing about this process is that people are so interested in it because they've never seen it before. You know, like it's still like like I said, like it's still an untapped thing. Like if there was that whole saying, like the riches are in the niches, like I think this is a really, it's an important niche because it's just so untapped. And like, I can't express that enough to people where it's like, if you want to try something and you're artistic and you're looking for something that nobody else does, then this is a pretty good way. You can go as deep as you want. You can use whatever wood you want. You can mess with the colors. Like, you know, just, we were always kind of expand, like we're always pushing the limit of what this product could do, the film. And I was just super surprised all the time about what it, kind of beating it would take and how it would hold, you know, when you got it wet with all that paint, because we're rough on these things. Like we make them real quick, throw them around, and like it's not a pretty sight whenever we make them, but it comes out perfectly and the mask holds. So when behind me, there's this wall.
Yes.
And this is actually, the whole thing is carved in. Like all of that, it's probably a half an inch deep. So, and that's on a huge piece of wood. And half of this is half of the wall that I built for a trade show. Because when I went to that show, it was, people were having a hard, at trade shows, you know how everything blends in, especially you're seeing so many different booths, right, and stuff like that. So a lot of people were just kind of passing over us. And I was like, man, they need to see what's going on here. So I basically, this was just to show them like, hey, this is all carved in here. They saw the wall, they came up and looked at the wall and they're like, oh, how'd you do this? And so I told them, and then they would look at the skateboards, and that's kind of how, that's how we would show it at the trade show. So this always means something to me because that's been with me since the beginning.
No, it's a beautiful wall. It's, I know it has the primrose. It's all etched and paint filled. I don't know if you can view it online, but it's absolutely a beautiful etched piece, all in wood and then paint filled. And I know that you do like to sand carve because you can sand carve those darker woods and then add a paint fill. So you have like many options when it comes to sand carve. And I believe that's what you mentioned to me before, is you have choice in color by sandblasting versus like using a laser when it comes to your product.
Yeah, so like one of the advantages about a laser, because I think everybody's looked into a laser of some sorts in their life because it seems so interesting. And I think lasers are really great for like little logo hits. And then I've also seen people do lasered decks, skateboard decks, kind of like what we're doing here, but it just doesn't have the same appeal. The thing that you get with sand carving is you can go as deep as you want, right? You're in control of that whole thing. So you have the story behind it. You got the story behind the process. You got the choice in your paint colors because you have that film on there with the laser. Like you can use a laser mask, but also it has a hard time burnt color in the wood, right? So if you use a darker wood, that thing's just gonna disappear. So, and I think, you know, people try to make it work, and I guess it looks kind of cool if you're going for that, but
I think I
the contrast is
so let me,
what's really important in the design for me. So,
okay. Well, I thank you, Gabe. You have an amazing story. It's, today we did a session, Carve Your Story with Gabe from straight.com. And his concept was strictly on take a concept out of need, and then using social media to film the process so that people can respect the product. And he's a young man, a passionate man when it comes to his product. But here's what we can tell you from Gabe is film, you know, record, document your process to gain that business, to gain followers, so people can see what you're doing and the hard work that goes into it. When you sandblast, You are creating depth. You're creating an item, a product that has a higher perceived value because of that depth. And then also adding a paint fill. So thank you, Gabe, for joining us and giving some of your tips. When it comes to wood engraving, let's look here. We have here this cutting board. Okay. Again, this is something that has like a coating on it. We put a mask on it. We sandblasted it. Now, when it comes to a cutting board, you have to have a food-safe product. If you're going to add any stain or any paint fill, and it has to be food-safe if food is going to come in contact with the surface. So here we used a butcher block stain, a mineral oil. So we left the mask on. We used a cloth, and after we etched it, we applied some of this oil into this engraved area. Now, someone came up with this design for me, so they did the board. It says Haas. It says, many have eaten, few have died. Okay? So I thought this is a cute artwork piece, a cute design for this particular cutting board. The second piece we have here is just a simple little gift. And you think of, we have, you know, many grandmas that are cooking and they have their secret recipes. This is a cookbook holder. So you kind of put her famous recipe on the back. What's great, again, when it comes to sandblasting wood is you get the depth and you can do a paint fill. So here we added a little red just to kind of pull out that apple pie, just kind of making it a little unique, a little different. You have some like your recycled wood that you can put your mask on, sandblast it, and again, revealing that wood grain that Gabe talked about, revealing and that kind of that wood grain just kind of makes that product. You kind of see, gives character to the item. And as you can see here, like these little coasters, we did this for an office party. And we had, you know, the world's best cup of coffee. And then we had like a lot of different little hot chocolate bars. So we put up these little wood pieces here. We sandblasted them. There were several of them, but we put them up for our employees just to kind of create a unique and a delightful area where people can come and grab their pastries. And it was festive. It's Christmas time when we put up those items. So let's take a look at the project that we're going to do today. It's a walnut bowl that I have here, and it's unfinished. So this is like raw material. And with wood products, I'm using a 6mm, and I'm using a brush-on adhesive. So when it comes to your wood surfaces, all right, sometimes we can have an issue with that self-stick laminating to the surface. And not so much this surface, but something like this. And I have two stencils here. One is SR 2000. And what we did here is we brushed on adhesive. Okay, so there's a layer of adhesive, no self-stick properties there. Okay, I'm going to put that on here. And then here we have the self-stick. Okay, the self-stick material SR 3000. I'm going to lay that on here. Okay, I'm going to squeegee these, and we're going to come back to this after I do my project, because I want to show the difference of what it's like when you peel away the self-stick material off of this particular wood material. Now, some woods, the self-stick works fine, but where we can have an issue is once you peel off that mask, after you sandblast it, is having a residue on that surface. Now, you can use WD-40. On most cases, to remove that residue using a cloth, a little bit of WD-40 on the cloth, and that'll help remove that residue. But sometimes you have that, you have that mark that's really difficult to remove when it comes to a self-stick material. Why? Because wood, what it does is it's a poor conductor of heat. Okay, when you deal with wood or plastic, it basically just kind of takes that film and laminates on top. So with self-stick, there's no layer of glue, all right? So you have to create a barrier between the mask and your wood surface, or this particular wood surface. It has a finish to it. It's more of your inexpensive press board type materials, which are very popular to sandblast or laser. And for your customers might bring you something like this to do, and you're like, okay, what am I going to use? And a lot of you use self-stick. That's the number one product that we sell is our self-stick film. You need to create a barrier. And sometimes a hairspray will work well, like a cheap hairspray. You can use soap to remove that residue, but it acts as a barrier between the self-stick film and the wood surface. So that residue from the self-stick or that adhesive doesn't transfer over. When we're dealing with the SR 2000, what we've done is you would brush on you would use your paintbrush and brush on a little layer of adhesive. And I thought I had an extra mask, but I don't. So you could use your brush and you would brush on some adhesive onto that stencil, and that would act as your barrier, because you're dealing with a water-based blastable adhesive versus a self-stick film that has no layer of adhesive. The film is like a naturally self-stick product when it comes to producing and manufacturing the item. Where the SR2000, you are applying that layer of adhesive, or you're spraying it on, and that acts as a barrier from the mass transferring over to that surface. Because we still have to sandblast. Sandblast, what does it do when you sandblast? It generates heat, and that heat will start to laminate that mask over to that wood surface. Same thing with plastic, but that'll be for another segment here. So let's look. Oh, so someone did bring me a stencil here. I'm just going to show you how you would brush on adhesive. This is cover paper. For those that are new joining in, this is a mask that's been pre-produced, and I'm going to remove that cover paper. I have my RZ2 brush on adhesive. I'm going to take a little dab. We're going to use a paintbrush versus using a foam brush. So we're just going to brush on a light layer. It goes on white. Okay, we try to do a nice even layer. Now what happens when you put too much adhesive? If you put too much adhesive, what happens is you start to soak up that re-wet the photomask. And if you've applied several layers or a large amount, let's say you use a foam brush and you brush on, you see little puddles of adhesive, and then you let it dry. As it dries, it should turn clear. However, if you put a lot of adhesive down, you're just re-wetting that mask. And then how do you know you have too much adhesive? Because it may look dry. When you try to separate that clear liner and it doesn't want to separate, that's a sign that the moisture went down into the mask and it's still wet between the clear liner and your resist material. So you need to put a hair dryer to it, put it in your film dryer, let it dry a few minutes. And that's when you have, again, too much adhesive that you've applied to the surface. But this is a perfect amount of adhesive right now, just a light layer. I would wash my brush, rinse it out. It's a water-based material, and then just let this dry. So that's how you apply adhesive to your mask material. You don't want to apply adhesive to the surface. If you apply adhesive to the surface and then you put the mask on, now you have residue. Okay, you're heating up, you're blasting, you're heating up that surface, and now you have residue that's going to be very difficult to remove. So you want to make sure that adhesive always goes on the photomask and not on the wood surface. Okay, let's take a look at our product here. So this right here is like a popcorn bowl, or that's not, more of a bread bowl. Okay, I was looking for a popcorn bowl and I could not find one. So here's what we came up with as a design. We're going to put on here salt. So think of this as a bread bowl. Salt, that life may always have flavor. The second one here is bread, so that this house may never go hungry. And the last one is wine, that joy and prosperity may reign forever. And if this sounds familiar, yes, it is from the movie It's a Wonderful Life. And it's a great movie, but I love the part where Mary presents the gifts to the new homeowners. And it's a short segment. It's a short, like maybe it's 30, 40 seconds in the movie. But I just love what she said. And so we're going to put these three items on this bowl. We're going to sandblast it. And we're going to paint fill it. So with this, we have April created my artwork. She created little lines here. And these little lines are supposed to line up on this area right here. Okay, so she's real big on me trying to put this on straight, and we're going to see if this works. We wanted to do one big mask, but because this bowl kind of shapes, it has like a bow, it curves down. So she created this artwork on a slight curve or warp, just to kind of get it to apply and lay down nicely. So I'm going to remove this clear carrier. I'm going to take my squeegee. I'm going to start to squeegee this down. Now I'm using 6 mil. Okay. six mil with a brush-on adhesive. I'm going to start to pull this off because I feel, because it's on a curve, that I can actually press this mask down easier without the clear liner. So I'm going to take this here. And then now I'm just going to kind of apply my pressure here. And again, this does have adhesive, but we're dealing with a different surface. We're not dealing with glass. I feel like glass is very easy to blast. And I was looking at our screen, so I did see some names. I know we have Nancy. We have India joining us this morning. We have Michael, and we have Jim. And I know we have, I saw UK up on the screen. And I saw Mexico up on the screen. I saw Abrasive Imaging, Matias. So I took a quick glance. And thank you for joining us today. Thank you for working through our technical difficulties this morning. I appreciate you guys staying on. It's not always easy to go live, I will tell you that. So I think because I have, I just want to make sure that I kind of line this up quick, evenly. And then what I'll do is I will remove the carrier. I'll squeegee this down just a little bit, and I'll remove the carrier. And let me turn this over. It's an odd-shaped bowl, but I think it could be a great gift. Now, I did see one of the questions that asked, can you sandblast wood and glass in the same cabinet with the same media? And it all depends on what type of dust filtration you have. So that is a big one. You want to make sure that you have a good dust filtration system on your cabinet that can recycle and separate. It recycles your abrasive, but also separates your debris out. So wood, it's a pretty fine product, and any of our systems would separate the any debris or residue from the wood surface, so you would have no issues blasting glass. So that looks pretty good. So I have one more stencil here. And I find it easier to turn this over just to line up this area here. I always love hearing stories of how people started their business, and I just was so fascinated with our special guest today, and he's a remarkable young man, and just so full of passion and desire, and it's wonderful to see someone have a business or have an idea and see that business take off, and that's what is so exciting about his business and seeing his concept and his designs come to life. And then seeing someone like my family or my children loving that idea, and it was a big deal for them to purchase something. So that was really nice. And if you have any questions for Gabe on wood, you can just send them over to us and we can make sure that he gets them, and you can go directly to his website and there's an area there to contact him. Okay, so let's take a look here. So we have bread. Okay, so now I just need to tape this up. Okay. And that looks pretty good. So we have them spaced out. I'm going to use some vinyl tape here. I'm going to be blasting probably, I'm going to be looking at about 40 to 45 pounds of pressure. Now, with these skateboards, he's blasting at unregulated pressure using a 6 mil design or 6 mil mask, very aggressive blast. So just when you're first starting out with sandblasting wood and going at higher pressure, I always recommend start at around 40 pounds and then go up from there. Go up 5 pounds as you feel comfortable, because you'll start to feel pressure coming out of that nozzle, And you want to make sure that that you have control and that you're comfortable holding that. When I was coming up with this concept here, I thought, oh, this is great. We'll do a design all the way around. But now that we're doing this, it's a lot of stencil material. So thank you for being patient with me. So send in your questions when it comes to wood surfaces. I will tell you that speaking with Gabe, we didn't get to what kind of paint he uses, but he does use the Gold Series, I found out. He started out with the Belt and Molotow paints, and then he moved on to the Gold Series by Montana, as well as the Black Series, which is a high-pressure paint. But he's dealing with big open area. He does a lot of paint blending. If you look at some of his designs, so they're all sandblasted with photoresist, and then he applies a paint fill. So I'm going to take a wire wheel roller right here, and then I'm just going to tape just the top. It's really important to use a wire wheel roller on this type of design because you're dealing with a curved surface that can have some air bubbles in there. So we want to make sure that this mask is laying firmly and nice and tight against this wood surface. In some woods, they blast really quick. Okay, so that looks pretty good. I'm going to add a little bit of a painter's tape on the top, just so I don't, when I bring my nozzle up, I don't want to hit the inside of the bowl. Okay. So we're just going to create like a little hat here, little rim. Again, this is a lot of engraving area here. One more little piece. And especially this is going to protect the bowl when I add a paint fill as well. Okay, so we look like we are ready to go. And I have my glove here. Normally, you'll find in some of the videos, I don't wear gloves. Sometimes I do. It all depends. If I'm blasting at a higher pressure, I generally like to have a glove on. So we're going to go ahead and put this in, and we're going to sandblast it. I'm using our 2034 VXA system, and this is adjustable in height, okay? So it makes it very nice to blast. You can stand up straight and etch with no issues. And then what's nice is you just have an easy foot pedal, real easy. Just kick this, and I like to step on the black part here. So first, what we're going to do is we're just going to set the mask. I'm just going to remove that membrane off. Okay. So now my mask, this mask is set. Okay. So now I'm going to come in, and I'm just going to start to go nice slow passes over my design. Try to stay straight on to your design. And then you can see that beautiful wood grain starting to show through. That looks really pretty. And because this is going on the outside, we're just going to add a black paint to this. But there are several paints out there that you can get, or stains that are food safe. So I encourage you to kind of take a look. an experiment. So let's take a look at that. You can kind of just see that wood grain there. Not a whole lot of depth, but let's move on to the next item here, or the next stencil. We're just gonna kind of set the mask. I'm gonna move through it quickly. Trying to stay straight on, moving my hand so that the nozzle is straight on or perpendicular to the design. So now that I set the mask, I'm coming in and now I'm doing etching for depth. You can see that's the glue being removed right there, that dark wood surface, just kind of blasting away, that's the glue. And depending on your detail, I mean, you could kick up your pressure here. I'm at 40, a little over 40. I could easily go up another 5-10 pounds with this mask. When you increase your pressure, yes, you blast faster, but you have to keep in mind how thick is your material and can it hold up to high pressure blasting. And the 6 mil, it's used by monument blasters for detail. So the 6 mil works great and can handle high pressure blasting with a coarse grit. Of course, we're using a coarse grit for production type. So generally people will use a coarse grit to etch faster and to get through their products quickly. So we're just going to set that mask. Okay, and now we're going to come in for depth. When you see something like that come up, like a little air bubble, you can just bring your nozzle kind of over it from this side. And then you're going to use what you're doing by doing that, you're going to use the air and sand to actually compress the mask further to the surface. And if you were watching a few segments ago, we kind of went over kind of reading your blasting pattern. And that is something that can be very important. When you're blasting, do you favor one side over the other? Well, you can kind of take a look at your blasting pattern. You can see I'm really dark here, but maybe not so much here. So you can tell that I'm favoring this area right here versus the and sign. So you wanted to always take a look at it and just see, are you etching in an area a little heavier? So read your blasting pattern. All right, let's take a look at all of the design here. Let's see that salt. I'm going to blast this one just a little bit deeper, the salt shaker. And I think that all looks great. Let's take a look at the bread. I'm just going to blast a little deeper right in here. One thing I notice when painting wood is you see that paint just absorb into that surface. So it's not like glass where it just kind of sits on that surface. But I notice like ceramic products, and like wood products, they have more of a, let's say like a porous surface. So what happens is it just that paint soaks in. So let's go ahead and use this air gun. We're gonna clean off the surface here, or clean off any dust or debris. Okay, so now we're gonna come over and we are going to start to paint. Let me move this out of the way. And I'm going to turn on my paint booth here. We're just going to use a black paint. But you know what? You can also use, let's look at the clear coat, because we want to seal in that area. Remember, we talked about this a few segments ago, is a clear coat can actually seal in the engraved area, and it prevents that paint from bleeding. So we're just going to do a light coat here. Let me turn this around, then we'll hit it with the hairdryer. The paint comes, or this clear coat comes out really fast, so you have to have short sprays. I'm gonna take our hairdryer and just kind of dry this real quick. Actually, that looks pretty, doesn't it? Kind of really shows a sheen over that wood and the different colors of the wood. Now I'm using 6 mil, but you know, for you laser engravers that want to add some color or you have an odd shape, use your laser mask. Laser mask is a great product, and if you're able to paint with it. So you just apply that laser mask as you would a stencil, put it in your laser your design, and then all you have to do is sandblast and then paint, just like I'm doing here. So now let's add our short sprays. Short sprays. That is key to painting. This stone tone paint, it's a high pressure paint. It comes out pretty fast. So I'm really trying to make sure that I do short sprays. So let's come around to the first one we did here. I'll come back to that. I can already see that. I see a little bit of wood color coming through that wood grain. Paint on purpose, okay? Your nozzle should be targeted. I don't need to paint up here. I need to paint on purpose. Paint the letters. Paint, make sure your nozzle is targeting where you're gonna paint. Now you can see here, So I need to come in different angle. Can you see all that area? It looks painted when you look at it from the front, but from the side, it's not painted. So let's go ahead and target this. Just coming at it from a different angle. That's looking better. Let's take a look at this one. Make sure you have light so you can view your item before you kind of pull the mask off. I have a little bit you can see right in there. I don't know if you can tell, but there's a little bit of paint missing right in that R. So we're just going to target that R. There we go. Okay. So let me go ahead and use the hairdryer just to speed this up. Now looking at this salt, I can see there's some open areas in there in the salt shaker. We're gonna let that sit for just a few minutes, okay? Let's go ahead and come back. We're gonna look at our two materials here. And let me take my squeegee. So I'm just gonna go ahead and peel off this clear liner. This one's this 2000 with brush on adhesive. And let me get this self-stick one off. I should have did. And I can already feel, actually, I can feel that self-stick really bonding to that surface. And actually, you can see here. Let's go ahead and lift this up. And it's really tight. You can actually see the little line here. Okay, now let's lift up the, I'm talking about the line from the mask. Let's go ahead and lift up our 2000 with the brush on adhesive. And yeah, there's nothing there. This is where we need to be careful. Okay, we need to be careful when we're using a self stick. Now, I just see a little impression here of the outline of the mask. Okay, it's a slight impression. Let's go ahead, I'm gonna remove this and I'm gonna use a little bit of WD-40. Now this is without me even blasting it, so I just want you to get a feel or understand what happens when we use self-stick on certain surfaces. And WD-40 is almost like a degreaser, so it just kind of really pulls off that residue there. And I don't feel it any longer, because you can feel like a little ripple, but it's no longer there. So WD-40 is a great little tip to use, a great product to remove any of that residue that could be on that surface. It's great for like metal surfaces. I haven't used it on plastic, but it's great for metal and wood surfaces, and I believe it would work just as well on plastic, but I'll have to experiment with that and let you know. So let's go ahead and take off our stencil material here. And let's go ahead and take a look here. Let's see what we have. We're going to remove our paint. I'm sorry, remove the painter's tape. Okay. Now let's remove this. See how nice that comes off. I'm having a harder time with the painters with the vinyl tape than I am the Photomask. The Photomask comes off really easy, and that's what we want. And I don't feel any residue at all on this surface. So let's go ahead and clean this up. Let's take, I'll take some tape. Let's see if this works here. Sometimes you can use your vinyl tape to remove the centers of your letters. Okay. And let me grab a razor here. We'll finish this up here quickly. I'm using the plastic razors. I love using them, especially like on metal surfaces. Oops, and then we'll clean this up. Again, I'm just using a 6 mil with brush-on adhesive. And you want to take your time when you paint on cleanup. You know, let it sit. Oops. Let it sit for 20, 30 minutes before you start pulling up the resist. Take my okay, so take a look there. And this is just on a walnut wood material. And we just used brush-on adhesive, and then I can use the butcher block to seal it in, and you want to apply several light coats with a clean cloth, let it dry. Usually they say 6 to 8 hours on drying time when it comes to using this type of oils. The mineral oil, I let it dry overnight. We did apply several coats to that, and it says, I was reading instructions on the mineral oil. It says like after 50 uses, reapply. So that's just some little tips, lots of research that you can do on different products. But here's our wood segment. Hopefully you got a few tips. We're looking at, let's take a look at our board here. We have Linda joining us and Donna. And Robert, nice to see you, or nice to see your names up on the screen. We have Evelyn, and we have Nancy. Thank you. Charles, thank you for joining us. Bob, Paul, thank you for joining us this morning. So the bowl, let's go over some questions because I haven't answered the questions. So let's go over the bowl. Where did I get the bowl? I got the bowl from Bed Bath & Beyond, and I liked it because it did not have the finish. How long can you keep the adhesive, someone's asking. Okay, so the adhesive, the RZ2 adhesive, you want to make sure that you shake that bottle if you haven't used it for a while, because it can start, the products in there can start to separate. So you want to make sure that you can shake that bottle well before you apply it to your surface. Now, if you shake it and it doesn't look like it's mixing, but maybe it's 3 years old, then it's time to get a new bottle. Okay, so I would say take a look at it 1 to 2 years after that. You might have to look at replacing that, but shake it well, and you want to make sure if it's shook well that it still has that sticky properties. Make sure it's sticky before you apply that mask to your surface. I have a question from Nancy. Are there any woods that are not safe to sandblast? I think you can sandblast pretty much on all woods. Wood is easy. I mean, I'm trying to think what's out there. Press board, you know, that may be a little more difficult because you're blasting through that coating and it may not hold up as well when it comes to wood surfaces. But you have, like, the bamboo is looks great blasted. This walnut surface looks great blasted. Dark woods you can blast and it look great paint filled. Let's take a look. Abrasive. What is the media choice for wood? Well, we like to use aluminum oxide when you're blasting wood. And we got this tip from Gabe, actually. He was using, he tried silicon carbide. If you, and what he said, that if you didn't blow out or you had one little grain of silicon carbide in your, in the wood grain, one little piece of grit in the wood grain, it sparkles and it shows through the paint. So he did not like that. So that's something to keep in mind, because it is an open area when you start blasting. You have the wood grain and that little grit can get in there. So Paul says the tips you gave me worked out. Okay, so with Paul, he was dealing with the self-stick film on leaving a little bit of a residue. So I asked him to try applying some hairspray. So I'm glad that worked, because, again, creating that barrier between the mask and the wood surface. Let's see here. We have Bob join us. Thank you. And I know we have Jim join us. Randy, thank you. Linda, what clear coat did I use? Okay, so I used a Krylon matte finish. Let me go grab it. And right here. Now, again, this comes out very fast when you spray it. So you want to make sure that you use short sprays to getting that clear coat in that area. And that works great on stone, bricks that have like a porous surface. That works really nice on. And then I'm using 150 grit in our cabinet today, but you can easily use 120 grit when it comes to sandblasting wood with a 5 mil or a 6 mil. With our film, 120 grit, it's gonna help you cut through that wood surface a little faster. And then let me see here, if there's anything else. I know I went over, but hopefully you can take a look at our website. Take a look at Straight's website. He has some unique products out there. Take a look at what he's done. And it's straight.com. It's S-T-R-G-H-T.com. And you'll just find some great inspiration, I believe, from his designs and from what he's done and the colors that he uses. He uses one stencil and he paint blends with different multiple colors. So that if that's something that you can take away from some of his products, look at the way that he paints and the colors that he uses. Very, very unique. And I just love the color that he uses. And let's take a look here. All right, you let me know if you have questions. We're here. As always, thank you for joining us. Thank you. We've made it 14 weeks. 14 weeks. All right, and you're still with me. And we're still going. And I look forward to every week with you. We have something special next week planned for you. But just take a look at some, get some ideas. Think about your concept. You guys are creators. That's one thing that Gabe said. Your customers are creators. They're not consumers. They're creators. What do you create? What do you do? What do you promote? What do you sell? I love the way he says document, film it, show it. People respect your product. I thought he had some great tips. I hope you're able to capture some of them. But as always, we thank you for joining us to learn sand carving. Learn sand carving. You have a story. And I look forward to seeing your story. Tag us in your posts. Tag us of what you're doing. We want to see what you're doing. So you have a story, and we want to see that. We thank you for being our customers. We thank you for watching, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Let me know if you have any questions. This is Liz Haas, and we'll see you next week.